Hello and welcome to the second episode of my online course on special relativity. My name is Andrzej Dragan. I'm a professor of theoretical physics at the University of Warsaw and National University of Singapore. And these were the Lorentz transformations that we derived in the first episode, which characterize motion as a hyperbolic rotation of space-time. So let us begin with a quick recap. So in the first episode, we have discovered that motion is in fact a rotation of spacetime. So let's consider a simple spacetime diagram with the vertical axis ct given by the equation x equals to zero. Similarly, the spatial x-axis is given by the equation ct equals to zero. And the same prescription has to apply to the moving observer, characterized by primed coordinates. Therefore, the x prime axis is given by the equation ct prime equals to zero, which, if we plug in the Lorentz transformation formulas, results in the equation ct equals v over c times x. And this equation characterizes a straight line at an angle phi relative to the horizontal axis. And tangent of phi is given by v over c. Analogous equation can be written for the ct prime axis, which is given by the equation x prime equals to zero. And again, if you plug in the Lorentz transformation formula, that results in the equation ct equals c over v times x. And again, it's just a straight line at an angle phi, but this time relative to the vertical axis ct. And this, by definition, is a hyperbolic rotation of a plane containing space and time. So, a long time ago, our ancestors used to use these devices to measure time. Nowadays, we use these kind of devices to measure distances in space. But all the fun begins when we put those two together to get something that we call space-time. So, let's have a look at some of the consequences of the fact that motion is actually a rotation of that space-time. So, let us imagine an inertial observer with a spatial axis x that observes two simultaneous events, A and B. So in his space-time diagram, those two events have to lie on the same horizontal line. And let's say that those events are separated by a distance delta x. Let us now imagine a second observer that is moving in a car with a relative velocity v, and that observer will be using primed coordinates. And in his space-time diagram that corresponds to the hyperbolic rotated axis, the situation is quite different. If he wants to attribute time coordinates to those two events A and B, he has to project those events onto his ct prime axis. And as you can see, the projection will result in a time difference, delta t prime, between those events. Okay, so the notion of absolute simultaneity is another myth. Simultaneity can only be relative. And that should not surprise us at all. Because we know that motion is, after all, a rotation of space-time. So, if I take a pencil and I ask you whether the two ends of the pencil are equidistant or not, your immediate answer should be by asking back, equidistant from what? Because those two ends can be equidistant from myself, but not necessarily from another observer for whom the pencil is rotated. Therefore, if somebody asks you if two given events are simultaneous or not, your immediate response should be by asking back, simultaneous, for which observer? So let's discuss the same problem from a slightly different perspective. Let's have a look at this interesting phenomenon, but from the algebraic perspective. And let's invoke the Lorentz transformation for the temporal coordinate t prime. Since the Lorentz transformation is linear, we can also add the delta symbols that describe differences between time and space, not just their absolute values. Since our two events A and B in the rest frame are simultaneous, that means that delta t is equal to zero. And again, we see that if those two events A and B are separated by a distance delta x that is different than zero, then also dt prime is different than zero. So in special relativity, there is this idea that is often repeated, but rarely understood. And it goes as a rule that nothing can move faster than light. I would like to understand what it really means. So let's have a look at a few examples.
Okay, so imagine a railway track with a poor guy lying on it comfortably in order to commit suicide. Eventually, a train starts to approach with a high velocity of 0.9c. But suddenly, another train starts to approach from the opposite direction, but the same speed of 0.9c. And now, our suicider begins to wonder at what speed those two trains approach each other, from his own perspective.
Okay, so if you define velocity as a change of the mutual distance between two bodies from the perspective of yet somebody else, then the relative velocity between those trains clearly has to be 1.8c. And there is nothing wrong with that, because in relativity we usually define velocities relative to a given reference frame. And not, like in this example, a mutual velocity of two bodies with respect to yet another observer. But let's have a look at another example.
Imagine a bunch of Lego figures standing in a row in fixed distance from each other, each being equipped with a watch. And beforehand they have all agreed to jump at a given time. The first guy will jump at 12 o'clock, the second guy will jump 1 second later, the third guy will jump 2 seconds after 12 o'clock, etc. And the purpose of this experiment is to create a wave that moves from left to the right.
So that wave that we have just created can move arbitrarily fast. After all, we can ask all the Lego figures to jump at the same time, and then we would say that the wave has moved infinitely fast. So if there is no upper limit to that velocity, then what does it mean that nothing can move faster than light? Does light have to move with the speed of light? Well, not at all. For example, this is a laser pointer, and if I aim it at my hand, I can just twist my wrist and the spot will move very fast. But if I aim it at a very distant wall, the spot on the wall can move with arbitrarily high velocity. There is no upper limit. So again, what does it mean that nothing can move faster than light? So this last example I want to discuss with you will temporarily sort things out.
In the previous example, we had two events, A and B, that according to the resting observer were simultaneous, while according to the moving observer, they were not simultaneous. And now let's move on to a new example that will help us understand what do we really mean by saying that nothing can move faster than light. Again, imagine two events, A and B, but this time they will be connected by a superluminal signal, which simply means a signal that moves faster than light. Let us now project those events to the temporal axis. Time between those events is delta t, and similarly the spatial distance between those events is delta x. Also, the fact that those events are separated by a superluminal signal means that c times delta t must be smaller than delta x. And now let's try to investigate what are the space-time coordinates of those events attributed by the moving observer. Again, we have to project those events to the tilted axis ct prime and x prime, and this time we find that in the moving frame of reference, the event b takes place before A.
Okay, this is completely crazy, because it seems that we have sent the signal from A to B, and yet in the new frame of reference, the signal is being sent from B to A. And these crazy situations arise once you allow superluminal signals to be sent. And that's why one usually makes an extra assumption on top of relativity to get rid of those signals and to declare that no superluminal information can be ever sent. But make no mistake, this is not a logical consequence of relativity. It's rather an extra assumption on top of relativity to make sure that the causal structure of the reality is preserved in all frames of reference. So it seems that we have already sorted out what does it mean to say that nothing moves faster than light. But this is not the end of the conversation. Soon we'll find out that when we take into account the quantum phenomena, for which the notion of causality is somehow disturbed, there will be more interesting things to say about that. Okay guys, if you made it this far in the video, that means you're a smart kid, which means that if you like the video, you know what to do, right? Also, if you're looking forward to the next episodes, you don't have to wait, you can actually get my textbook on relativity
on which the whole course is based. It's available on Amazon. It's called Unusually Special Relativity. The link is in the description. But today, the party's over, so get some life. Get out here. Okay.